I was the kind of kid that took stuff apart when I was a child and rarely was able to put it back together again. But I always believed that I could fix something. And just maybe that's the kind of person I am, where if something's broken and I have the opportunity to fix it, I want to do it now and right now, whether that's 2 a.m. or whatever. We are right at the heart of where the biggest problem lies. London is clearly a polluted and congested city. There's a high rate of asthma and other breathing illnesses in London now. You just need to go out into the traffic and, you know, open your car window, and it's gross. With a classic car, the journey itself becomes an adventure. You know, you're not always certain you're going to make it there. You're definitely not going to make it there as fast and as comfortably as you would in a modern car. And that forces you to change your routes and change your perception of travel. And I don't think anyone's in any doubt or would argue too much that classic cars have more character. They bring smiles to people's faces as you drive by. They're evocative, they're emotional. And so people are keen to have them. People are keen to see them. People who own classic cars are, there's a degree of emotion around their ownership. They own that car and they drive it because they love it. It's easy for them to say, you know what I would really love is my beloved car, but it's electric.
Because it's a different display, then it's a
standard. The goal of London Electric Cars has been to offer affordable conversions. And one of the most significant costs in a conversion at the moment is the cost of components. And the reason they're so expensive is because they're brand new and they're difficult to come by. And I also realize that if you find a secondhand component, they're quite often around quarter the price of a new component. Which then led me to the process of, okay, where can I find a consistent supply of secondhand components that are readily available? And unfortunately, in the UK, we make Nissan Leafs in the Nissan factory. And I realized that it's very common to find Nissan Leafs in salvage yards. So we're able to pick up an entire car. And with that, we get all the contactors, we get the motor, we get the batteries, we get the battery management system. We get the heating system, we get the wiring, we get the fusing. Basically, almost everything we need to convert a car. The challenge, however, is to be able to use those components outside of the Nissan environment. And that's something that we're just beginning to complete.
So we use an Xbox Kinect sensor and combined with a computer to scan cars. Now the scan isn't really accurate, but it gives us a rough idea of what the car will look like in the 3D design. So we can design our battery boxes and components and then place them inside the car and see roughly what it will look like in position. If there's anything in the way, we can then adjust in our design and go take actual measurements of the car.
Between the battery pack and some of the associated electronics, the boot is pretty much filled up with that car. There's also batteries underneath the seats in the passenger compartment as well. The car's personality changes quite a bit. With electric drive, you have power right from zero speed, unlike a petrol car where you have to build up power. So it's very quick off the line. You end up being a little bit heavier than a petrol version of the car just because of the batteries, not the motor itself. But the car, the Mini, handles it very well. It's a fun car to blast around in.
So one of the really interesting things about what we're seeing with electric cars, electric propulsion, is the enthusiasm we're getting from young people. I mean, Theo is a perfect example. They're keen to know about laptop batteries. They're keen to know about electric propulsion. They're keen to know about things that they can do themselves at home to embrace the change to electric.
I've always liked cars from a young age. My first word was car in Swedish, so I've always had a connection with cars, and I like to make things and design components. So working here, I do stuff lots with my hands, I do lots of fabrication, I do lots of design, and I do lots of kind of problem solving. The first 3D printer I just bought off the internet, and it got sent from China and arrived. Now to assemble it fully from scratch. The trouble with printing is that every time you print, you don't know if it's going to work or not. So you've got to have the settings changed or dialed in until you know they're going to print every time.
Having access to 3D printers has been revolutionary for us. It enables us to prototype stuff very quickly. It reduces our fabrication costs immeasurably. So rather than sending a component out to be fabricated and then getting it back, realizing we've made a mistake, we can now 3D print that part and at the very least check that it fits. Check that we haven't made any stupid mistakes.
But it's also useful to make boxes. So if you have like components that don't need to be structurally strong, but they can be 3D printed quickly and custom designs, custom shapes, custom everything, mounting positions and everything. So it's just really easy and simple and quick.
Canada definitely has a classic car culture. It's not as strong as here. Here is a very strong classic car culture, much stronger. There's car shows every weekend, really.
He approached our stand and said, I really love what you guys are doing. I have arrived in England from Canada.
And at one point I said, just out of the spur of the moment, I said, are you hiring? Are you looking for people to help you?
He said he'd retired and wasn't looking to work too hard. He'd worked in nuclear power stations. He was comfortable with electrics. I invited him along and he was brilliant and continues to be brilliant.
I'm very passionate about classic cars and just love working on them. I've owned a few. When I was really young, I would take apart my bicycle every winter and rebuild it for the riding season. To be able to work on classic cars with other people that are passionate about that as well is great. A customer will bring us a car that is suitable for conversion. We start getting into the car, we take the old petrol engine out and associated systems with them. Then we put in the electric motor and it takes some time to do the physical arrangements and mountings and all that stuff. And once that's done, we start adding the electrical components, the battery systems, the control systems, and then finally we integrate them.
How that process actually undergoes is obviously the challenge. But on the whole, we rush to each of the stages and then fill in behind it. So we'll rush to get the motor, the wheels spinning. And if that presents a problem, then we'll figure out what that problem is.
The batteries take a lot of room. That's probably one of the biggest challenges, is figuring out where to put them and how to best to manage that. Even off the shelf components and that, it's not always clear as to how to make everything work and integrate properly. We've progressed a long way in that area, and it's going to be great products coming out the door for sure.
So we received the Morris Traveller about 6 months ago or more, and I've been working on it. So it's been a long process, and it's finally got to the stage where it can drive on its own, which is quite good. We put all the batteries in, wired up the high voltage system, all in a test position, and it ran on its own power. And you just sit in the car and then you can just drive it very slowly, forwards and backwards. It was the first one that I'd got to the stage of driving, and it felt pretty good.
Firstly, it's the first Morris Traveller that I know of that's been converted in the UK. I only know of one other converted Morris Traveller in the entire world, so it's one of only two in the entire world. that it really represents for the first time us being able to deliver on something that I promised from the very early days of London Electric Cars, that we will be able to offer affordable conversions using secondhand electric car parts. With that, we have done one of the first examples of the Nissan Leaf motor being coupled to an existing gearbox, where we've also kept the ability to use the clutch so you can continue to change the gears if you want to while you're driving.
It's a big deal. Everybody has put their hands on that car to make it work. It means a lot of work has been done to get to that point.
First car we converted, so I drive it every day. It's a 1953 Morris Minor Series 2, and all the bits that you can hear rattling are the 1950s parts complaining about being used on a daily basis. The electric parts work beautifully, and they're nice and quiet.
But yeah, people are always surprised.
It's natural state, which is what this is. Dead silent, which is represents a really sort of psychological change. I find you lose this urge to race everywhere, partly because the acceleration away from traffic lights doesn't involve this sort of noisy crescendo, and as a result you tend to just meander places. You're also you become more aware of the environment you're in. It's got a name, it's called Oswald, and it's very much part of the family. It's already 65 years old. I don't see a reason why it can't make its way quite happily to 100 years old and still keep functioning in exactly the same way as it is at the moment, which is very much part of the whole sort of repair, recycle, reuse ethos that I think is really important for us to start to develop.
And this car will do about 40 miles.
In reality, the average journey in London is around, I think, 6 to 10 miles. So I recharge this once a week. It costs me £1, £2 to recharge it.
One of the limiting factors on electric cars is shorter range than, say, a similar petrol car. But that fits well with classic cars because generally they don't go on longer trips. They're used more around town or for Sunday drives. The customers love the cars. Yeah. And they love being able to drive around and in a clean car, but yet have fun and have that old car vibe. So I love classic cars. I have my whole life. I'm passionate about them. When I see them on the road, it's a thumbs up. When you're driving them, people are always looking. They stand out, and I'm just glad to be able to be part of something that keeps them on the road.
In the UK, we have 34 million cars approximately on the road. The global figure is, depending upon where you read, anywhere from 1 billion to 2 billion cars in the entire world. And that represents a massive problem. What are we going to do with those cars as we go to carbon zero? We need to convert those cars to electric. There's nothing wrong with the steering on them. There's nothing wrong with the electric windows. There's nothing wrong with the leather seats. There's nothing wrong with the braking system. They're fine cars. The only problem is the propulsion system. But at the end of the day, our mission is to convert as many cars as possible.